and the spectrum of its insult is limitless. However, the management protocols of different people are different, and the general ophthalmologist is often confused as to how to deal with such situations. From, you know, so we'll be tackling a spectrum of areas over here, from the lid, adnexa, to the orbit, to cornea, to sclera, including how to tackle the lens, and also dealing with chemical injuries, and then how to take care of retinal trauma, and then how to read a CT, and the role of radiology in such cases, and then finally going to traumatic glaucoma. And the most important aspect that comes about is the medico-legal aspects of it. So I'll invite my co-instructors, Dr. Santosh Honawar, sir, to come on the stage. Dr. Indivar Mishra, the rest are on the way and they'll be here. So we'll start off first also with Santosh sir's topic on lid and adnexal injuries, including the orbital fractures. And everybody knows Santosh sir. Santosh sir is a legend in the field of ophthalmology, the ultimate authority of oculoplasty and ocular oncology, not only in India but also the world. And I think a person like him needs no introduction. It's just the word Santosh Honawar speaks for itself. Thank you.
Thank you, Karan, for having me part of the course. I'll be speaking on eyelid and canalicular trauma and very briefly about orbital fractures. When you have a patient coming to you with eyelid injury, the initial assessment would include the location, exact location and the extent of injury. The most important is to see if there is any margin involvement, because the repair is different if there is margin involvement, the depth of the wound and canalicular involvement. So when you talk about extent, you talk about anterior lamellar defects which involve skin and orbicularis, posterior lamellar defects involving tarsus and tarsal conjunctiva, and full thickness defects, obviously, as the name indicates. And if there is tissue loss, sometimes in road traffic accidents there is tissue loss, part of the lid is torn and it is not retrievable, and based on the extent of tissue loss it can be mild, moderate or severe. Now whenever there is a medial canthal injury like that, it could be because of road traffic accident or because of even a blouse hook injury in infants, then you should suspect canalicular injury, especially when the injury is right beyond, a couple of millimeters beyond lateral to the medial canthus. Like that, canalicular injury is imminent, more common in the lower eyelid, the less common in the upper eyelid. So when you want to repair it, there are certain principles. You should never trim a skin wound, because eyelid skin is so vascular that it will take up. Even if it looks bad and necrotic and very fragile, you still want to use it and suture it, because you don't want to lose any skin. Then when you suture it, it should not be like this. It should not be a straight wound. It should be everted. That's called a little pouting. So when you produce that kind of a pouting, then the plane of scar will be in line with the rest of the lid. Otherwise, there will be dipping, especially because lid tissue does not have subcutaneous tissue. It is skin and orbicularis. Lid skin is the thinnest skin, and if you don't pit it, or if you don't cause this kind of a pouting when you suture it, then generally you end up with a scar. So how to get a pouting kind of a wound? So this is the trapezoid way of closing, where the posterior part is broader and the anterior part is slightly narrower. See this, although the wound is like this, the suture is exactly in the opposite manner. The apical part of the wound will get a broader base suture, and the broader anterior part of the wound will get a narrow suture, so that the wound becomes pouting. Slight eversion is mandatory. So that's called an inverted trapezoid shape. Now when it doesn't involve the margin, it is very simple to suture. Obviously, I said no trimming, direct suture, and whenever you suture skin orbicularis, it has to be sutured in layers. Orbicularis with an absorbable suture and skin generally with a non-absorbable suture. But if the patient will not come for a follow-up, or if the patient is just traveling by the city and has a trauma, then you can use even absorbable sutures such as Vicryl for, or even Chromicatcut for skin. And the results are very good. Despite who does the surgery, skin being so forgivable, if you just take care of the anatomy or alignment. Alignment being, there are three aspects. One is the lid crease. If the lid crease is aligned, if the brow is aligned, and the lid margin is aligned, if these three things are aligned at the time of surgery, then you'll get wonderful results. If these are not aligned, then they will remain unaligned. Next issue is full thickness defect. For example, this patient has had a full thickness defect, and this is how you assess the tightness of the wound. So when you bring the medial and the lateral edge close together, if they're meeting perfectly, then that is an ideal situation. If they're not meeting perfectly like this, there is a gap, then you have to do what is called lateral canthotomy and cantholysis. Now for the upper lid, you do a superior cantholysis. For the lower lid, you do a inferior cantholysis. This is a very, very simple technique where you simply use a tenotomy scissors and cut the lateral canthus, that is lateral canthotomy. And then you go straddle the lateral canthal tendon and cut one crust. For the upper lid, upper crust. For the lower lid, lower crust, as I said. That will give you about 20 to 30% relaxation, thus enabling the apposition. Having done that, marginal suture is very, very simple. It follows what is called 5-3-3-5 rule in the upper lid and 3-1-1-3 rule in the lower lid. What it means is that from the cut edge of the lid margin in the upper eyelid, for example, you are 3 millimeter away, that is when you enter. For example, you start entering from here, this is 3 millimeter, this is 5 millimeter. So you enter at 3 millimeter, go 3 millimeter deep, exit at 3 millimeter, enter at 5 millimeter, go 5 millimeter deep, and exit at 5 millimeter, and then tie. So that will cause eversion of the lid margin or pouting of the lid margin. For the lower eyelid, you follow the similar principle but 3-1-1-3 rule. Why do we follow it? That's because upper lid tarsus is about 8 millimeter and you have to be at least 2/3 depth in the tarsus for it to approximate well. So remember the depth of the tarsus or the height of the tarsus, whichever lid you are operating, you have to be at least 2/3 depth into the tarsus. Suppose this is the tarsus. You have to be at least 2/3 depth into the tarsus to get a good closure. Now this for this patient, for example, you know, you can easily suture it by doing a small lateral canthotomy and cantholysis. So this patient is approximating very well. So you don't have to do anything. I'm just going to show you the technique. We use a 6-0 silk for margin. You can use 3 suture technique or 2 suture technique. I prefer a 2 suture technique. This is the first suture. 5 millimeter away, 5 millimeter deep, 3 millimeter and 3 millimeter. You can see the nice pout there. Can you see that pout? That is the end point. After that, you suture the tarsus to the tarsus by using vicryl sutures. When you suture the tarsus, don't go to depth, full thickness depth or conjunctiva because these sutures will rub on the cornea. So never include conjunctiva when you suture the tarsus. Tarsus will have tarsal conjunctiva approximated nicely. The rest of the skin sutures are with silk or proline, your choice. The marginal suture has to be everted like that and tied on the skin so that it does not go and rub on the cornea. That is the principle of eyelid marginal suture. They work very well. As you see here, this patient has an extensive injury, but following after six weeks, he doesn't have any stigma of injury. So unless you follow the anatomical landmarks, then only you will have residual defects. Otherwise, generally, you won't have residual defects. When it involves the levator, how do you know? Whenever there is a lid injury, but if there is fat prolapse, if the septum is injured and there is fat prolapse, most likely that the levator is injured. Or if the lid injury vertically extends beyond 10 millimeter, that is where the levator is, then levator is injured. So whenever levator is injured and horizontally transected, you have to identify the transected levator and suture it back. Okay, whenever there is a canalicular trauma, then you use either mini monoca or one of the indigenous tubes. Mini monoca is very, very nice way of repairing the canaliculus. This is how it looks like. It comes ready to use, but you can cut it to any length. So you dilate the punctum, identify the medial cut end. So that's through the punctum we are passing mini monoca. And then tighten it so that gets fitted into the punctum, and then identify the medial cut end under microscope. If you have difficulty in identifying the medial cut end, then you can use a drop of drosin which will blanch the rest of the tissue, but the cut end remains white, or under high magnification you can see it, or inject air under a pool of saline. In any case, you'll be able to identify the medial cut end in many situations. You leave the mini monoca stent for about 3 to 4 months, and then you simply pull it out in the OPD. That results in cannulation success of about 90% to 95%. So this is a patient with dog bites, repaired similarly. For complex trauma, of course, you have to be very careful not to produce this kind of a defect. This is a medial canthal tendon avulsion. You have to reattach the medial canthal tendon, otherwise you'll have this kind of residual defect. For small tissue loss, you can use an advancement flap as such. And late repairs, if a patient were to come to you with a notch like this, you can simply excise the notch by using a pentagon and repair it. That's called a late repair. And notches like this, patients who have come with mal united lid can also be repaired nicely using a pentagon technique. So in orbital fracture, the main presentation features are inophthalmos and hypoglobus. This could be a late presentation, but early presentation, generally patients come with proptosis because they would have orbital hemorrhage, sometimes emphysema and inflammation. So when that starts resolving with the use of steroids, you will find that the patient will have inophthalmos, hypoglobus and a deep supratarsal sulcus. So when you do a CT scan in a patient with orbital fracture, you find this. This is called a teardrop sign. And if there is a medial wall fracture, you will see that the medial rectus is bowing into the paranasal sinuses. When you look at the ocular motility, the main sign that you will have is inability to elevate the eye. That's because the inferior rectus gets entrapped in the fracture. If the inferior rectus entrapment is posterior, as you see here, that leads to a reverse lesh effect, and the patient will have difficulty in looking down. So generally, this is what you find, difficulty in looking up. But in rare situations where there's a posterior incarceration, you will find that the patient contradictorily will have a difficulty in looking down. So the patient will have diplopia. So when do you plan surgery? If a patient has diplopia with CT evidence of entrapment and non-resolving ocular cardiac reflex, when the muscle gets entrapped into the fracture, the patient will have ocular cardiac reflex. That is an indication for immediate surgery. This generally happens in children. Otherwise, early surgery is done at 2 weeks. 2 weeks following initiation of steroids and antibiotics. So if a patient has suborbital fracture of more than 50% of the floor involved, if inophthalmos is more than 2 mm, hypoglobus of more than 2 mm, and infraorbital nerve hypesthesia, then you would do an orbital fracture repair. Principle is release of entrapment, placement of a barrier, and repair of inophthalmos and hypoglobus. This is a very brief video. I'll just run through it. This is a patient with an orbital fracture of the floor. This is a young child. She has come at about 10 days following injury. She has a bro injury which has not been repaired, which is granulating. And that is a small fracture that she has with incarceration of the inferior rectus into the fracture site. You can do a 3D reconstruction of the CT scan to get a better planning. This is a simple fracture in the sense that there is not much of a large defect as such, but a small fracture with incarceration. So you start with bridling of the inferior rectus muscle and then do a small lateral canthotomy and an inferior cantholysis to get access to the inferior fornix. That's the inferior cantholysis. This technique will be useful even for eyelid reconstruction. Then you pass a suture through the upper eyelid to keep it away. Then pass a few sutures through the lower eyelid, cauterize the area where you are going to make your incision, that is a conjunctival incision just short of the inferior fornix. Then you retract the tissue, engage the tissue that is in the fracture by using spatula. So it's a hand over hand maneuver. You assess the tightness of the tissues, and if tissues are very tightly adherent to the edges of the fracture, then you might even want to do a small osteotomy using a bone punch, DCR bone punch, so that tissues can be disengaged without trauma. Otherwise, if it is possible to disengage the tissue, then you do that using hand over hand maneuver. The goal is to keep on doing it until you see the posterior edge of the fracture. You can start seeing the fracture now. That is the fracture from which tissues have been disengaged. You can see the posterior edge of the fracture. You have to actually see the posterior edge of the fracture and do a force detection test and make sure that it is negative. Then use this simple barrier sheet, which has one polished surface and one rough surface. Polished surface comes towards the orbital soft tissue and the rough surface goes towards the bone. Place it in between the orbital soft tissues that you have retrieved from the paranasal sinus and the fracture, and put in a drop, few drops of cyanoacrylate glue, the same glue that you use for corneal perforation. definitely you can use much better material such as titanium sheets and screws and plates, etc. But this, if you're a comprehensive ophthalmologist with some taste in oculoplasty, and if you have a simple fracture, you can definitely repair it using this kind of a technique, which is fairly simple. But for complex fractures, of course, you have to use complex repair procedures. So this is the same child who had upper eyelid, upper motility restriction. Now, following surgery, he is, you can see that his motility has reversed and he has come to be ortho. And this is the patient who had enophthalmos following secondary repair. His enophthalmos and hypoglobus have nearly settled. And there is one more child that I show here. So you can see that initially there was severe restriction of upward movement, and following surgery, it has become normalized and the child is rid of diplopia. Thank you so much.
Excellent talk as always, sir. So I have a question over here. So as general ophthalmologists would be, like, sometimes when there is a complete avulsion of the lid or something, that there's difficulty in identifying the LPS. So what tips would you like to give for that?
If there's a complete, a complex eyelid tear, then I would suggest that they refer to oculoplasty surgeon. Because if levator is not identified in the first go, then the patient imminently will have severe ptosis. And in a secondary setting, it is very difficult to repair such a ptosis. So it is better that if they find an oculoplasty surgeon close by, they can refer. And it is not mandatory that eyelid injuries are repaired on the day that patient comes. You know, it can be delayed for 3 or 4 days without any implication on the results. So it is good to refer such patients where there is complex.
One more question, sir. Such cases somewhere, suppose if somebody is in the very periphery and they don't have a mini minoca stent with them, can the IV cannula be used instead?
It can be used as long as it is used atraumatically and the bulbous end is formed at the puncta. You know, by cauterizing, you can form a bulbous end, just like you do a scleral fixated lens by using a cautery at the suture, proline suture. You can also cauterize the IV cannula and make it bulbous. But that is a crude way of doing it. Definitely you can do. But mini monoca stent is very easily available now. It is not, doesn't come, Indian one doesn't come as mini monoca. It is a oro stent. Oro makes it and it is quite inexpensive. It is possibly 1/10 the cost of an IOL, so you can definitely use it.
Yeah. Right? So in fact, mini monoca, the FCIs after being marketed by Zeiss has drastically reduced the cost of the mini monoca. You get a set of 3 for 4,000, which is as exactly the same cost of oro stent.
Correct. So either of which is fine, but I like mini monoca because it is more refined in the sense that it is very nicely engineered, whereas oro stent is slightly innovation type.
Are there any questions from the audience? Okay then, thank you so much. Sir has to rush to another session. So next we'll have the talk on CT scan and radiology, on how, what's the role of it in ocular trauma and how to read it, by Akshay Nair. Akshay Nair is a leading oculoplasty surgeon in Mumbai. He travels all over. He's an important part of UC as well. And he's got a good sense of humor.
I hope that helps us in this talk. So imaging in trauma, I think Dr. Unnavar sir has made my job a little easier by already showing classic case examples and the signs to look out for. So my overview is going to be the basics of what these scans are, the primary imaging, CT, MRI. In what case scenario do I request for what investigations, and a little bit of what's new. So CT scan is basically a glorified X-ray because it is essentially a patient in the CT scan machine with an array of multiple ionizing radiation sources that are passed through the patient, and at the end, at the posterior to the patient on the screen is a, just like you would see this, a rabbit in front of a light source, a shadow being following, shadow falling on the wall. Here you have a source of illumination being the ionizing radiation, and depending on the density of the tissue, you get an enhanced version of an X-ray. This is detected by the amount of ionizing radiation that passes through the body and reaches the screen is detected by the specific detectors, which then merge multiple X-rays and create the CT scan. So you can see that the patient, there is one rotating X-ray tube here, which is the, and then this keeps going all around, and at multiple angles it goes through, and there are fixed detectors all along, and then they collate the image and give you. In MRI, it is not based on radiation. It is based on the fact that the most abundant element in the body is hydrogen, and the most common compound is water. So the hydrogen atom in each cell behaves like a singly charged proton. Basically, to simplify, this is a giant superconducting magnet, and when electricity is passed through it, there is an electromagnetic field that is generated. So all the protons go from a low energy state to a high energy state. Once the electromagnetic field is withdrawn, they come back down, and the energy that is released is the MRI signal. So I'll come to this. These are 10 commandments of imaging. So CT or MRI. CT is preferred even now for most orbital lesions because it gives the greatest detail about bony and periorbital structures, and it has very specific indications and is more useful in deciding trauma. CT, now here you can see that although this is not trauma related, that there is some bony remodeling and a tumor on the lateral wall. Here there is a large tumor intraconally, and here there is a bony tumor. Now, two things that you can see here are that in this scan, the bone is very densely visible as white, with no internal structures being visible. Whereas here, no soft tissues are seen, but the bony architecture is well seen. That's because this is a soft tissue window and this is a bony window. It's basically the radiologist playing with the density of the tissue on, it's like Photoshop for X-rays or CT scans. So when you ask for a CT scan, what do you tell the CT scan? You have to tell the CT scan, the radiologist, the area to be imaged, how thin you want slices, what are your imaging planes, whether contrast is needed, and any other specific modification. If there is a facial trauma, remember it is better to advise for CT orbit. If you advise for CT brain and CT orbit, that adds to the charges for the patient. And whenever the orbit is imaged, every radiologist does routine screening scan of the brain. So unless you're specifically suspecting intracranial trauma, I would request that, you know, you shouldn't ask for CT brain, because that would, you know, add more for expense for the patient. So how do you read a CT scan? The first scan that you see on the top left, this is always there in every CT scan. This is known as the scout view. This just shows the, now if you see, it looks like exactly like an X-ray, because that is what it is. And each of those lines are planes through which the CT scan has been passed. And on the body, there are three planes. There is a sagittal, coronal, and axial. So similarly, you have to tell the radiologist what plane you want. Oftentimes, a sagittal plane is not routinely included. And the thickness of the slice is the distance between two images that this radiologist will procure. Just like a loaf of bread, you can either ask for 1 mm or 2 mm. So if you see the coronal moving from front to back, here you can see that this is the eyeball within the two orbits. As you go posterior, you see the extraocular muscles and the optic nerve. The space within that is the intraconal. The space outside that is extraconal. You will see that optic canals and the orbit tends to narrow. The sinuses get wider as you go posteriorly. And towards the apex, you see that the sinuses are far more wider. This, from there, you come to the ethmoids and the sphenoids, and the optic canal becomes thinner. In the coronals, your landmark is your eyeballs, and to the superior lateral to that is the lacrimal gland. These are axial slices where you will see the section that passes through the optic nerve and the lens. These structures are the lenses here within. And these are sagittal or parasagittal slices. Sagittal is the only one that passes through the midline. Anything parallel to that is parasagittal. This is extremely important in trauma. So the first thing you do when you pull up a CT scan film is to see if you're exactly seeing the same patient. I know it's basic, but many times, you know, in busy radiological practices, there may be a mix-up. How do you figure out which is right or left? You keep your eyes open. Similarly, you look for things where they've mentioned contrast, where it is plain. Most scans now have it very clear. Any enhancement which is seen as hyperdense is contrast. Also, the terms used, hyperdense, isodense, and hypodense are for CT. Hyper-intense, hypo-intense, and iso-intense are for MR. Laterality, all scans usually have a right or left mentioned on them, so you don't have to worry about which is what. Like I mentioned, this is the soft tissue window where you see more clarity about the soft tissue muscles and the optic nerve, whereas this is a bony window where bony architecture is better seen. Landmarks in the CT scan, the soft hollowing or the scalloping that you see superotemporally on both orbits is the lacrimal gland fossa. Going posteriorly, you will see the angulated orbital floor. And then you have the intra and the extraconal space that helps you decide where, if there is a tumor or a foreign body, what is the location and the description. In trauma specifically, if you're looking for imaging of the optic nerve, 1 mm cuts are required. Otherwise, 2 mm cuts are standard for the orbit. When do you use contrast? When you're suspecting vascular lesions or inflammatory lesions. You can see a patient with post-traumatic CCF has a dilated superior ophthalmic vein and the CCF also enhancing here at the apex. Special conditions when you would ask for a patient for special procedures, this is Valsalva, a patient who had intermittent proptosis. You want the patient to perform the Valsalva maneuver while the imaging, that's not coming in the video here. It came, okay. So finally, what do you image for what? So there can be only 5 scenarios. Acute loss of vision unilateral, acute loss of vision bilateral, gradual loss of vision unilateral and bilateral. So in acute loss of vision unilaterally, your area of interest is the nerve and the optic chiasm. If there is no history of trauma, your choice of investigation should be MRI. If there is trauma, then CT. This is an inflammatory cause. Now here, you can't see the optic nerve because the fat is also hyper-intense here in T1 weighted. Once you suppress the fat, you can see that the optic nerve is hyper-intense, suggesting an inflammatory pathology. Similarly, you can suppress, there is fluid suppression, which is then help you identify inflammatory lesions better. Acute loss of vision bilateral, your area of interest is post-chiasmal pathway. Investigation of choice should be an MRI or NMR contrast. If it is gradual, unilateral progressive loss of vision, area of interest is optic chiasm and the orbit. Most common cause is usually orbital tumors or compressive optic neuropathy. Again, the choice of investigation should be CT. And finally, gradual bilateral loss of vision, post-chiasmal pathway, investigation of choice should be MRI with contrast. CT is preferred in oculoplasty, like I mentioned, because of giving you a lot of information that helps you decide the surgical findings. In certain scenarios, the fundus can help you guide what investigation you have to do. So, coming to trauma specifically, I'll wrap up in a couple of minutes. What do you look for? Bone windows, like I mentioned, the position and the integrity of the orbital floor, the orbital walls, the optic nerve and the optic canal, and finally foreign bodies. So, when you look for the optic, the orbital floor, what do you look for? Like Dr. Hunavan mentioned, this is the teardrop sign. But sometimes there can be just fat that has prolapsed or periorbital tissue that has prolapsed and gotten entrapped with the muscle being intact. So how do you know whether you operate this patient or not? Now compared to these two scans, now here you can see there is a huge defect as compared to the intact side. Here again there is a huge defect with the muscle definitely bowing inside. Now the size of the defect is almost the same. Here there is no muscle prolapsing into the maxillary sinus, but here there is. Which one do you operate? Here the importance of, again, same thing over here. There is a bony fragment, the muscle is still within the orbit and not prolapsed. This is where a sagittal scan will help you figure out whether to operate or not. Large defects sometimes may not have the muscle prolapsing into the orbit. Those can be observed. But a sagittal scan shows you how big the fracture is here that needs surgery. Again, similarly here, the muscle is in the orbit, but a CT scan tells you that the defect is quite large. And it's not preoperative only, postoperative also, imaging helps you figure out where to place your implant and how the implant is placed. Other walls are equally important. In medial wall instruction, in medial wall fracture, special instructions to the patient not to blow their nose, not to sneeze, not to cough, because the force, intrathoracic intra-abdominal pressure increases and air can enter from the sinuses into the orbit, creating air into the orbit and that crepitus can be very, very vision threatening also. Finally, the optic nerve, what do you look for? You are in a setting of trauma, you want to see if there's a bony fragment impinging on the optic nerve. This is a surgical emergency and you have to go and operate immediately. Again, not so subtle. You can always compare to the normal side. You see the optic canal is quite wide over here, but the optic canal here is narrowing because of this bony fragment over here that has come in there. Similarly, very subtle, but you can see the bony disruption here compared to this side where there is no bony disruption. This is impinging on the orbital nerve and you are in the optic nerve and you at the apex, and you may have to go in and displace it. Metallic foreign bodies. Now, this is a patient who fought with his roommate or landlord for over 50 rupees, and the landlord took a knife and stuck it into his orbit. You can see this is entering the right cheek, and you would immediately think of going and removing it. But if you see the CT scan, it's entering the right cheek, right maxillary sinus, the medial wall of the right maxillary sinus, the nasal septum, apex of the contralateral orbit, complete optic nerve transection of the left side. So we were surprised that the patient was PL negative in the left eye, but had this foreign body in the right maxillary sinus. So CT scan, especially when you are suspecting metallic foreign bodies, is the investigation of choice. And here we had to go in with an ENT surgeon who could then localize it through the sinuses and help dislodge the foreign body. 3D reconstruction scans are very useful. This was a scan. It tells you where the exact location is. This shows you, this will give you the idea that it's outside the orbit. This again gives you the idea that it's outside the orbit because these are single images. When you do a 3D reconstruction scan, it tells you that it's actually within the orbit. So especially in cases of trauma, foreign bodies, a 3D reconstruct scan is very important. I'll wind up with, this is my last slide. This is, we normally in our cities, we have 1.5 Tesla or 3 Tesla MRI machines. This is an image from a 30 Tesla experimental MRI. You can see each individual axonal fiber of the optic nerve going in, and the arrow points out to the lamina cribrosa. So in the future, there is a good chance that you may get a near tissue or a histopathological diagnosis simply based on imaging, because the resolution is getting so much better. Thank you. If I have any questions, I'll be happy to take them.
I have one question.
Sure.
So what's the role of when to go for a plain CT and when to go for a contrast?
So if it is a setting of trauma, a plain CT is enough. Contrast basically goes through the blood vessels. So if you're suspecting a vascular lesion, if you're suspecting an inflammatory lesion or an infective lesion, contrast can be done, contrast should be done, because you would see contrast enhancement in inflammation, leakage in vascular lesions, or the vascular lesion would light up because of pooling, and same is the case for inflammation, infection as well. So if you don't, and of course there are different grades of enhancement in infection versus say a tumor, which can also help you differentiate the two. In certain situations where you suspect an aneurysm, again an MRI, a CT angiography would be advised, which will then show you any vascular loop. So if it's trauma, plain is good enough, but if it's infection, vascular or inflammatory, contrast is better.
What about traumatic optic neuropathy? What scan you'll advise?
So traumatic optic neuropathy, 1 mm cut, CT orbit.
CT orbit. 1 mm cut.
1 mm cuts, coronal and axial slices.
Yes.
With the permission of the chair, if I take 1 minute to just discuss traumatic optic neuropathy, there's no consensus on the treatment.
Yeah.
And a lot of people still go ahead with heavy megadose steroids, which is 1 gram BD for 3 days.
Yes.
The current, in fact, at the American Academy last year, they had a symposium on this and a debate. The current consensus by the NANOS, the North American Neuro-Ophthalmic Society, is to completely withhold steroids in the setting of traumatic optic neuropathy. Sure. So they say steroids now has no role. And the presenter who spoke in favor of that was Dr. Kenneth Steen Sapir, who in 92 was the author whose paper he induced a crush optic neuropathy injury into mice and treated with steroids and saw some improvement. And that was the basis for starting steroids. But over the past 30 years, he himself has now changed his stance and said absolutely no steroids, not oral, not intravenous.
No, I have had some patients who have come to me after 2 or 3 weeks of traumatic optic neuropathy, not treated, okay? And I have treated them with steroids and they improved.
Right.
What is missing for that?
So if you see that there is some literature that has documented I'll just pull out that slide. Spontaneous recovery in traumatic optic neuropathy.
It's very rare, Akshay, but...
No, sir, it's anecdotal...
No, my opinion is that I think we should give the benefit of doubt to the patient by giving the steroids.
Right.
Nothing wrong in giving the steroids, you know. Whether it works or not is a different issue. Mm-hmm. But I have had patients, even after 1 or 2 months, they have come.
Can you put the slide there?
What's your experience, Anand?
Yeah, I think I'm pretty much first to hear that steroids these days, they've completely said that it doesn't work now. But at least 3-4 years back during our residency, that was the first thing we used to do.
Right.
And there was no harm in giving. That's what used to be our consensus.
Right. So yeah. These are patients, studies where patients were treated with steroids, improvement ranging from 40 to about 60%. These are studies where the traumatic optic neuropathy was not treated and spontaneous recovery was noted, again ranging from 40 to 60. And so this was the other paper in IJO, and again, Steen Sapir. This was written by Rohit Saxena from, all of the authors are from RPC, and they said that the decision to give steroids has to be on an individual case. And in commentary, you know, he written very, very categorically, I disagree with the authors. High-dose steroids should not be given for traumatic optic neuropathy under any circumstances. So I think it's a case-to-case basis, but they're just saying that there is lack of class one evidence.
Just a comment, are they actually using generic steroids from India, actually? Are they not working these days?
I guess that was a wonderful talk, Akshay Nair, sir. And we'll move on to the next talk by Anand Pasari on corneal and scleral tears. So Dr. Anand Pasari is a product of Elvi Prasad Institute, the prestigious one. And he has also been trained at Dr. Price in USA. And currently, he's working in Nagpur as a cornea surgeon and in private practice now.
First of all, thank you, Karan, for making me part of this instruction course. So after we've learned about management of extraocular, that is the lid and the orbital trauma, we come to the ocular or the globe trauma, that is the management of corneal and the scleral tears. So it begins with proper history. So when, how, and where. First and the foremost important is a detailed history of injury. So what is the mode of injury? How long has been this injury? Documenting the appropriate time? And what was the most probable object which caused the injury? So this gives a very valuable insight into the possibilities of any unsuspected or occult globe injury, posterior scleral rupture, presence of any intraocular foreign body, and presence of any concomitant microbial contamination, which might have happened because of the trauma. So once you get document the appropriate history, then we go to the proper preoperative evaluation, and we look out for the anatomical landmarks on the slit lamp very carefully, which include especially looking at the limbus, any stellate edges of the wound, the pigmentation lines on the epithelium due to any trauma or previous ocular pathology. And the very important is to look at the angles of the laceration, which may be present. There might be any debris which we need to be removed during the procedure, and presence of any iris or vitreous strands which would be removed during the subsequent procedure. So once we have evaluated and we see that it's a simple full thickness wound, then if the wound size is more than 2 millimeters, there's no doubt we have to go and suture it, and there's a need for a definitive surgery. But if the wound size is less than 2 millimeters, then we need to look if the wound is self-sealed or not, that we come to know by performing the sedal test using the fluorescent dye, And if it's a self-sealed wound and it doesn't leak even after performing a forced sedal test, then we can leave it to heal by itself, or we can apply a bandage contact lens. But we need to take appropriate precaution and need to go and suture it in especially mentally retarded or non-cooperative patients, or especially children who might rub the eye and lead to the wound leak later. In less than 2 millimeters, sometimes there might be stellate edges, or there might be a tissue loss. So, and it might be difficult to suture it. So we might need to perform a cyanoacrylate glue and apply a BCL to it. So once we have, we understand that the definitive indication of a wound repair, that is a corneal or a scleral tear repair, we need to keep it in mind what are our primary aims and what is our secondary aim. Our primary aim is to salvage the globe, and that would be by performing a procedure which will lead to watertight closure and structural integrity of the globe. And our secondary aim is to achieve a good curvature, avoid distortion, and so that there is minimal astigmatism, and at the end we achieve a good possible wood strength. So what are the suture materials we use for it? So preferably for cornea we use a 10-0 nylon or even a 9-0 nylon, and for sclera vicryl or braided silk is used. And we generally use a spatulated needle for both for cornea and sclera rather than using round-bodied needles. So let's come to management of corneal tear repairs. So we need to understand for certain principles for corneal suturing. So it has to be the minimal tissue handling, so as to just the needle touches the cornea and as possible, and minimal grasping of the wounds so as to avoid the maceration and the cheese wiring. The entry has to be 0.5, a millimeter away from the wound, and it has to enter perpendicular to the wound margin and 90% of the depth of the tissue of that is of the cornea has to be achieved, and so as to we have the epithelium to epithelium position, and preferably the spacing should be equal on both sides. Unless there is there are vertical or shelved lacerations. So there comes the importance of the concept of zones of compression. So the zones of compression are formed due to the application of the suture. So it depends on the length of the suture. Here we can see. So this is the zone of compression, which is a kind of a rhomboid shaped. If we go and increase the size of the length of the suture, then the zone of the compression increases. And if the length of the suture is decreased, then the zone of compression reduces. So it is important to have overlapping between the zones of the compression between the two sutures so as to avoid a wound leak. Here we see in the lower figure, the zone of the compression of the two sutures doesn't overlap, and there is a possible site of a wound leak which might not be visible on the immediately intraoperatively because of the pre-existing corneal edema, but these wound tend to leak later, and which might lead to shelling of the inner chamber. So the compression factors depends on the area of the compression is dependent on the length of the loop, and it is preferable that smaller sutures should be applied in the visual axis, as longer sutures in the visual axis lead to greater tissue distortion and greater astigmatism. And this is a video of a simple corneal tear. This is very small videos, just to have a look at it. So this is a very small. So this is a very small corneal tear, which is hardly 2 to 3 millimeter, and so it's hardly 2 to 3 millimeter in length, and the suture is directly passed with a no-touch technique, directly just even without the grasping the other end of the wound. And since the AC entry chamber is pretty much formed in this thing, whenever the entry chamber is not formed, we can form it using a viscoelastic substance or even with air if there is no leakage of the air. So I won't be discussing about the presence of any concomitant lens trauma or intraocular foreign body, because that would be discussed by the subsequent speakers. And at the end, the aim is to achieve a tight closure, and there should be no end leak at the end of the procedure. So next, we see, come to a case of a limbus to limbus corneal tear, in which the most important thing is to apply the first suture at the limbus, because this gives the best anatomical integrity, anatomical opposition, and then start the suturing. Oh shit, I'm sorry about that. Yeah. So first suture has to be always at the limbus, which gives a very good opposition, and then starts suturing in the center, and then divide it into different halves, and that's at the end of the procedure. So whenever we have a limbus to limbus tear, and which is pretty much straight, then we apply a technique called Rousset-Hayes technique, in which a repair is started with longer sutures in the periphery, and the length decreases as we go to the visual axis. And then the corneal center is closed with smaller and widely placed sutures with minimal compression zone overlap. So this leads to the better contour of the cornea at the end of the procedure. So we often come across triangular flaps in which the first suture has to be applied at the apex of the triangular flap, and then subsequently perpendicular sutures are applied to the edge of the wound. Rather, we need not to have parallel sutures as we have in case of straight wounds. So this is a case of triangular corneal tear, in which we can see the first suture is applied at the apex of the triangular tear, and then subsequently other sutures are applied towards the other sides of the triangle. And that's at the end of the procedure. Its AC is pretty well formed, and air leak is checked. The chances with that, we come across stellate wounds where there is a certain amount of tissue loss, and we might need to put some bridging sutures. And a use of a purse string sutures might be required in this case, as seen in this image. And there might be a need of a combination of both bridging sutures and the purse string suture. And even after that, if the gaping is still there, that we need to apply a cyanoacrylate glue along with the bandage contact lens at the end of the procedure. Okay. So these are the purse string suture, in which the suture is begun from one side, the needle is passed, and then we complete the circle, and this often seals the perforation in case of the stellate wounds. So coming to scleral tears, or the which often have a corneoscleral component, similarly, the first suture has to be applied at the limbus. Can you look at it? Okay, so there's not much into scleral tears actually. The first thing is we need to apply the first suture at the sclera, at the limbus, and then start suturing the cornea, and then start the sclera. First, very important is to have the conjunctival peritomy to see the extent of the wound. Of the scleral component. Often we don't, often it is seen that the end of the scleral tear is not seen, because it goes pretty much posterior, and that leads to a hypotony or the wound leakage later. So very important to expose and see what is the exact extent of the scleral tear. It is a proper repair of the corneal and the scleral tear can is not only globe salvaging and can prevent disastrous complications like endophthalmitis, but when done appropriately and meticulously, it can provide very useful vision and often restore near normal vision in select cases. So thank you. If any questions are there, I'll be happy to take.
I think one point I'll disagree on you, Anand, is that for perforations less than 2 millimeters, always I prefer that, you know, you should pass sutures whenever possible because glue has its own problems, vascularization, then you have to handle it. So yes, glue is a very good option for tears when, you know, after suturing there's some sort of a wound leak or something. One, sometimes when you don't have any tissue available and there is a lot of tissue loss, for the general ophthalmologist, what you can do is, even after suturing, if there is a lot of gap and still the glue is not working, you can actually use a drape and put glue on it and stick it to the thing, and so it it gives a good tamponading effect. Along with that, in such cases, it's very, very important to bury the sutures, and because you've had some tissue damage over here, the epithelium might have gone, so it's a good idea to put the BCL at the end of surgery as well.
Yeah, so the thing is, I get your point. You're saying that glue we I'm suggesting only in cases when there is a tissue loss. When in less than 2 millimeter size, if there is no wound leak, the sidus negative, then we can just leave it aside. But only in cases of tissue loss, when you know that suturing is not possible and it won't seal the wound, then I'm suggesting that cyanoacrylate glue might be needed.
Agreed on that, yeah.
What about, Anand, what about corneal tear along with cataract? So do you do it in the primary sitting itself, yeah, or do the corneal tear and, okay, Karan will take.
Yeah, actually I didn't take touch that part, but certainly primary corneal tear repair is preferred, and then subsequently in the second sitting, the cataract would be preferred. I think Karan wouldn't be elaborating on that, but we might need to do the lens extraction when the AC is certainly very shallow and it is not forming at the end of the procedure, or there is certainly there's a lot of cortex in the anterior chamber, we might need to aspirate it. But would prefer in the second sitting, that gets to better refractive outcomes and more predictability.
Okay. Thank you very much. Nice.
Thank you.
Nice talk.
We'll move on to the next because Dr. Indaver also has to moderate a session at 10:30. So we'll move his talks a little bit earlier, where he'll be speaking on traumatic glaucoma first. Dr. Indaver Vimal Mishra is currently doing his private practice at Bala Niritralaya, Mumbai. He's a product of Shankara, Coimbatore, and then he worked at Arvind Eye Hospital, Pondicherry, followed by M.M. Joshi Hospital, Hubli, and then at Agarwal's Institute, Tamil Nadu as well.
You just touched all the institutes.
So I missed out LVPI.
you still have a chance for a short term.
Rajan Sai, yes sir. So good morning everyone. My topic would be traumatic glaucoma, which is little more common than the tears and the breakages and little more subtle when compared to the other injuries what we have seen up till now. Fantastic talk, Anand.
Thank you.
The incidence of developing traumatic glaucoma, it is approximately 3.4% to 2.7% in blunt and penetrating trauma, but this is in the Western literature. If you go with the Indian data, the incidence is comparatively higher. Apparently, we Indians are getting more injured. It is around 4.5%, but there are certain case reports case series where they have said even the incidence can be approximately 9 to 10%. Now, the types of glaucoma which can develop after a trauma are early onset and late onset. The description and the types of the causes have been given in the two boxes. Not going to enumerate them. There are certain pictures which show the immediate post-traumatic condition of the eye. Most of them are direct injury to the cornea, to the iris, to the lens, and injury to these three main structures is the main responsible factor for the development of the glaucoma. Now, hyphema is one of the most common findings we find in blunt trauma in the Indian scenario. Most of the times we are unable to decide what to do with that hyphema. Now, in the hyphema actually causes a mechanical blockade of the trabecular meshwork. The inflammatory cells which come along with the RBCs, the erythrocytic debris which are there once the RBCs are getting, they are broken into small pieces, and the pupillary block. Most of the times the hyphema is small enough for us to just observe. But the greater the size of the volume of the hyphema, the more the chances that the increased the intraocular pressure will be increased. Now, when will you intervene? You have to learn to grade the hyphema first. You have to understand what is the extent of the hyphema. Many a times you have frank blood, then you have the blood clot, then you have the dispersed hyphema which is just settling down. You have to understand whether it is the dispersive hyphema which has just settled down, which will be little more translucent in color, or is it a frank blood clot, or is there a fresh bleed? Once you have understood that, you have to go on to the grading. The grading actually is helpful in two conditions. Most of the cases of trauma are either accidental or they are MLC cases. So if they're accidental, we need not worry. But the MLC cases, you have to really mention each and every point in detail. The grading of the hyphema is again enumerated here. So non-surgical intervention, surgical intervention, these are the only two things which we need to understand. The non-surgical intervention, good enough for grade 1 to grade 2. Shield the eye, it is basically to prevent the photosensitization of the blood products, to prevent corneal blood staining. Restrict the activity of the patient, ensure that the patient is in the sitting position, or he does in the 30 degree head elevation, 30 to 45 degree head elevation. It is basically to avoid the blood from staining the other structures and settling down in a single place. Relieve the discomfort, give patient cycloplegics, steroids. This is to decrease the inflammatory mediators and avoidance of straining. See, what we can kind of forget, the majority of the patients in my practice who have come with hyphema with increased intraocular pressure, they keep on coming back with rebleeds or the increase in the height of the hyphema. I try to find out what is exactly the cause. And very honestly and embarrassingly, 70% of the times, these patients are suffering from constipation. I don't have a study to prove it. I don't have not done a pilot study. But honestly, this is what has been my observation. I gave them laxatives. Patients are very happy. Now, non-surgical intervention, you go with AGMs, timolol, brimonidine. The aqueous suppressants, they do play a great role. But there are two schools of thoughts. Certain people say that you should not give aqueous suppressants, basically because they want more aqueous to be formed so that the RBCs get washed off. Old school of thought. The new school of thought is to protect the optic nerve, reduce the pressure as early as possible. Avoid pilocarpine, increases the vascular permeability, may increase the inflammatory mediators. Oral carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, intravenous hyperosmotic agents are really a good modality of managing the IOP in the short term. Avoid PG analogs. They actually increase the inflammation and they tend to increase the IOP as well. Sickle cell disease, for those of you who come from that sickle cell belt of Nagpur and Vidarbh region, it's earlier, it's better to operate on such patients. Go with cleaning of the AC, washing of the AC. Even if the IOP is not high, it is better to wash off the hyphema as early as possible. Rebleeds are always a problem. Remember your MBBS knowledge, not the loved one, the actual thing what you studied in second year. The blood clot comes, plugs the bleeding vessel. Now the bleeding vessel will start to repair itself. If the blood clot is removed before the bleeding vessel has a chance to recover, there will be a rebleed. You need to give the blood clot and the bleeding vessel time enough for it to start recovering. You know, you go ahead with cleaning of the AC a little early, even if the IOP has been little lower side, you actually give the blood vessel a chance to rebleed again. So amino caproic acid and tranexamic acid, we remember studying these drugs in gynecology in postpartum hemorrhage. These drugs actually can be utilized, titrated well in the post-traumatic period when the hyphema or rebleeds are happening. You need to really understand the physiology and the patient. There are no certain guidelines, to mention kis patient mein karna hai, kis mein nahi karna hai. You have to go case by case. Hyphema surgical intervention, there are certain set of guidelines which have been given. IOP more than 50, grade 3 hyphema, 8 ball hyphema, appearance of corneal blood staining, and IOP remaining high despite of maximal medical management even on after first or second day, go ahead with surgical intervention. Surgical intervention can be in the form of washing of the AC, it can be an early trab, depending upon patient. Late onset glaucoma, angle recession is the most common form, but it's a misnomer. Angle recession does not mean that there is a glaucoma. Angle recession is just a finding. It can accompany glaucoma. You all know what it is. It is basically a disruption of the circular and the longitudinal fibers of the ciliary body band. Mere presence of angle recession does not dictate that the patient is going to develop glaucoma. Angle recession present, you just keep on observing the patient. And angle recession basically means that the trauma was not trivial, it was severe enough, which actually causes the trabecular meshwork to have a lot of damage. This damage translates into scarring in the later stages, in the later part of the life of the patient, which is in turn responsible for the glaucoma. So angle recession per se is not the cause, it is just a finding which helps. It's a guiding light. Now, the predictors for post-traumatic glaucoma along with angle recession, these are the few points which have been given in the literature. Certain materials just mentioned 1 and 2, the other ones mentioned 3 and 4. I just compiled them all together over here. Late onset glaucoma, ghost cell glaucoma, it is the RBCs. You know, once they become spherical in shape, the hind bodies are created, they are khaki in color, they get collected in the trabecular meshwork, they can come from the vitreous side, they mechanically block the trabecular meshwork, causing an increase in the IOP, and these can be managed quite well with medical management. Very rarely you need to operate in a khaki cell glaucoma or a ghost cell glaucoma. Late onset glaucoma, usually, the trabecular meshwork is badly damaged. It's a progressive disease in the later stages, and it progresses much faster than POAG. So in such cases, medical management may be tried for the initial 4 to 5 months, but a surgical intervention is what is eventually required. Penetrating injuries, they behave usually more or less like the blunt traumas, the non-penetrating injuries. Only in the cases where lens particles are there, the anticapsule is ruptured. In these cases, you need to go with a complete surgical intervention. Otherwise, management of the primary wound and medical management of the glaucoma usually suffices. Again, there are no fixed guidelines. You have to decide from case to case. If there is extensive damage, you might have to go for a primary trab. For a trab after the primary wound has healed up, which might be quite early, as early as 15 days. Traumatic glaucoma in children, this is something which is rare. The eyes of the children are a little more forgiving. There are a lot of cases. The IOP, initial increase in the IOP is difficult to judge, basically because children don't cooperate with the IOP measurement. The cornea is a little more resilient. Even with the increase in the IOP to around 45 to 50, the corneal edema doesn't usually develop many at times. Acute settings, yeah, it does develop. In the chronic settings, it does not. You have to have a good degree of suspicion that the IOP is rising. It is better to intervene early in these cases, because if the IOP keeps on increasing, the patient developing glaucoma and damage is little more faster when compared to adults. Surgical intervention, if vitreous hemorrhage is present, this was actually a study in PGI. So if vitreous hemorrhage present in children, 50% of the cases actually required surgical intervention. Thank you.
Next, wonderful. Yeah, you'll start with the next. But one question for you. Yeah. What would be the ideal time to do a gonioscopy in closed globe injuries and after a repair of an open globe injury?
Okay, closed globe injury, there is no ideal time. If you feel that the angle structures can be seen, you can go ahead immediately. Penetrating injuries, I think the cornea surgeons would be a better judge of understanding that. But see, even in a post-operative cataract, I have done gonioscopy on day one. If you keep a good, clean gonioscope, there has to be no indentation. But a Sussman type of gonioscope can be kept on the cornea, and you can do a proper gonioscopy, or on the table can be done.
I think we can move on to the next. Do you have any comments?
Yeah. So next, I think
next talk by him only on the documentation, consent, and medical legal issues with ocular trauma.
Okay. So I'll be a little brief on this. I'm filling in for Dr. Jignesh Daswala. So medical legal issues in eye are something which are a big, big problem. Most of the patients nowadays, even with trivial trauma, come to us saying that I cannot see. They usually relate their old disease to the new trauma and try to, you know, file a case. And these things are very, very, very common. Yesterday, I mentioned one point. I had a patient 20 days post-op coming to me. He had subconjunctival hemorrhage, post-operative cataract. I accidentally mentioned, it was actually quite naive of me, I mentioned severe SCH, severe subconjunctival hemorrhage. And that severe word was what the patient caught. Went back to the old surgeon who had operated for the cataract just 20 days back. And he said, ki you owe me money. Because of you, I'm having a severe SCH. The patient did not understand what is severe SCH, but he just understood the word severe. Fortunately, that old guy, the other surgeon, is a batchmate of mine. He called me up and then I called the patient back. I counseled him. Things went smoothly. But such small adjectives can cause a lot of trouble. So you have to be really very, very, very precise in whatever you are mentioning. All that we are doing right now will be insignificant if you commit a small error in writing, in documentation. Remember, you will have MLC cases coming in, day out. If you happen to mention one wrong word, it can land you up in a soup. Indian medical system is going the American way. If you have friends in your American system right now, ask them. Every patient that they are saying, every word that they are uttering from their mouth, they are very judicious in doing it. Potential legal litigant, correct, sir. So whatever you're doing right now will have implications or might have implications on your practice 10 years down the line. Another case, simple. Patient had gone, had jumped from the first floor, small baby of 7 years. After that, she landed on her feet and then fell down on her butts. But she started waddling. The GP, general practitioner, MBBS, from a very old reputed college of Bombay, diagnosed her on x-ray saying that ki she does not have any abnormality, saying that she is normal. She grew up, and this was in 1989. I know this because that guy, the doctor who diagnosed, he was from my father's batch, 72. Now, 1989, the girl grew up in 2005. The waddling continued, pain in the hip joint. She went to an orthopedician. Orthopedician said that slipped epiphyseal head bilaterally, causing secondary osteoarthritis in that young female. Treatment was bilateral hip replacement. She went back to this first GP, who was the family physician, sued him for 1 crore. Finally, out of court settlement of 58 lakhs. He practically had to sell his clinic. He was a practicing GP in a village. Unfortunate, but has happened. Now you can understand that whatever you are doing today, don't think that you're safe. 10 years down the line, you might land up in a soup. Everything that you're mentioning, be very judicious. So I'll just go ahead very fast. Role of an ophthalmologist, provider of first aid, expert opinion needed, or postmortem. These are the three categories in which I've divided my talk. These are the three ways in which we can be involved in the legal process. Patient is alive, how to proceed? If the patient has come to you, decide whether MLC case or not. For a case to be MLC, there should be history of assault, there has to be a foul play, accidents including road traffic accidents. Even if it is an actual accident, it has to be considered MLC. Patient or patient's legal guardian request to register as a MLC. You cannot do it, the policeman has to do it, but you have to inform the policeman. Registration of the patient is absolutely necessary. The famous dialogue from Munna Bhai actually holds very true once you are into your private practice. Now, how to document? Documentation is the most important part. Even if you give first aid, doesn't matter. Even if you are not treating the patient, doesn't matter. The documentation is very important. These are the points which I've mentioned. Most of you know all of the points, but three main points have to be remembered. Identification of the patient is absolutely necessary. You have to take a Xerox copy of, a photocopy of all the identification documents which the patient has provided to you, as well as the relatives, as well as the witness. Second thing, you have to inform the local police officer. You have to note down his docket number, the name of the constable, what time you had informed him. Also, whoever was in charge of the police station at that moment, because this is what I've faced personally. I had called up the person in the night, police officer. The patient had come to me, did not take first aid because when I was asking too many questions, he got a little irritated. He left. Later on, I had called up the police officer, but later on I came to know that that man had committed a murder. During the scuffle, he had actually sustained injury to his eye, because of which he had developed traumatic hyphema. Luckily, I had noted down the number of the constable. The constable had informed the police officer that this doctor had called. I was safe. Patient's signature or thumb impression along with witness's signature is very necessary. If you don't have the witness along with the patient, you can manage with one of your staff. Before the examination, take a valid consent. Consent is absolutely necessary. Don't touch the patient. You have to take the vision of the patient, because many a times it has been noted in literature, patient has got a good vision. Once the doctor has examined, they have come back to say that once the doctor has touched me, I lost my vision. Be very vigilant. These things are there in the literature. If you are oriented and if you read towards these things, you will understand what is happening. Video consent is the best thing right now. Always and always note the vision. Trust me, vision is the most important part. Examination steps, same like what we have studied during MBBS. Look at the patient, then touch the patient, then go ahead with the complete examination of the eye and document everything. The type, location, dimension of the wound, presence and absence on foreign bodies, important negative signs as well. Court of law now has individualized the medico-legal cases. It does not follow a rule. It does not follow the old cases. They actually individualize each case now. You have to understand your case will be treated as a unique case. Don't think that you can cite the old judgments and get away with it. Important negative signs also are needed to be entered in your documents now. This is what the latest order says. Classification of the wounds, simple eye injuries, grievous eye injuries. You have the various classification systems. I'm not going into detail. This can be found in any of your ophthalmological books. Again, the classification of the open wounds, closed wounds. Now, expert opinion. The eye is an important organ. You have to understand whether you are an expert or not. Even if you are not an expert, if you have a degree, you will be considered an expert. You may be called upon any time by the court. When you will be called as a third party, when you have treated or examined the patient as an expert or as a legal proceeding against your own self. God forbid that should not happen. When an ophthalmic mishap happens in the hospitals, in the camps, government hospitals, charitable hospitals, you are a private practitioner in the vicinity, you might be called upon. See, these are the places or these are the conditions where you can be summoned by the court. Trust me, any one of us can be summoned. It's usually the top brass who is called upon. You know, Mumbai mein there is Dr. Lahane sir. So he'll be called upon. He is already an authority. Everybody knows him. His judgment will be the final authority. But don't think that he would, you know, you would not be summoned. You can also be summoned. So make sure that you have already read all the laws and bylaws which concern the ophthalmic circle. How to opine? Be very precise. Don't use any adjectives. Include your time, date, place of examination. Very, very, very clearly in writing, you have to give it. If you are unsure about your own writing, ask your staff to write it and supervise it. Definitive opinion should not be given unless asked. You should always give differential diagnosis in case it is available. Potential medical legal problems that you might face in your private practice, malingering, which is very common. I'll just wrap up. This is the last slide. Malingering, you have to go ahead, read all the tests which can be done by the general ophthalmologist for ruling out the potential causes of malingering. Second opinion for various diseases. I just told you, I gave you an example. Thank you.
So excellent talk. One thing I'll just advise on that is that don't write GVP, write guarded visual prognosis, because GVP can also stand for good visual prognosis. So I'll go to my talk now. Can you connect this? Yeah. Yeah. So the talk is the tackling the lens post open globe injuries. Karan Bhatia. So cut short. See, lens injury is the most common form of injury that's associated post open globe traumas. And actually the outcome is generally much poorer due to the associated injuries rather than the trauma itself. So a preoperative assessment is extremely important because it's and helps in planning and what you're supposed to do, the size of the tear, what is the location, whether any lens is involved or not, what is the status of the vitreous, whether it is prolapsed or not, whenever there's an unAC depth or even a sign of that indicates basically site subluxation. You can also go to retroillumination and look for that the edge, lens edge in case of subluxation. The role of radiology has already been explained in the previous talks. So there's always a disparity between the preoperative findings and the intraoperative findings. So when you're going in, if you suspect there is vitreous, always inject triamcinolone and confirm. So the first step every time in any such cases, subluxated lenses, trauma, is to actually do a vitrectomy first and then proceed to the normal handling the lens. So this basically is according to the hair database. As you can see, if you see preoperatively, it is also involved intraoperatively. But posteriorly, sometimes you suspect that the posterior capsule is intact. However, you might land up in a surprise that there is some sort of a trauma is actually damaged there itself. So it can be an anterior or posterior breach. You can have an intraocular foreign body. So be prepared for any intraoperative surprises. No treatment is generally necessary for the breach of the lens itself. So so this is a video that I'll show. Is it working there? Yeah. So this is a small tear with a cataractous lens over here. So in such cases, what you can do is you can suture up the, you can put the iris into position, then suture the corneal tear. And in such cases, you can convert these sort of breaches in the lens capsule. And then you can actually do an aspiration of the lens matter and then put an IOL in that. So I'll just brief through this video fast. However, sometimes what happens is you're always in for a surprise. So this is a simple case. I'm moving forward without any problem, but look, there was something happened. So we'll go through a little bit in slow motion. You can see that there's actually a PC tear that had happened over here. Now this could be a pre-existing one or did happen with because of my carelessness. That's different, but then in such cases, always tampon out the vitreous, do an automated anterior vitrectomy, always try to do automated, and that's the dictum nowadays, and then you can always put a multifocal IOL in the sulcus or in the back. So this is a very good video that I found on YouTube by Dr. Deepak Magore. He makes fantastic videos. And in such cases, what is shown over here is there's a corneal tear with an intraocular foreign body, and there is a lens perforation as well. So in such cases, this is from his video only that I'm showing, that the planning on the incision is very important. Now the incision should be opposite to the area of the tear or the foreign body. So in such a case, rather than a temporal one, I would go for a 12 o'clock position because the large foreign body can come through that area out. So this is his video. So what he has done first is that he's injected OVD inside, made a scleral tunnel, and then he has gone in and then taken out the intraocular foreign body and see how large it is. And then what he's done is he's sutured the tear, and followed by what he's done some aspiration of the lens, and then when he's got this edge of the anterior capsule, he's converted into some sort of a rexus, enlarged it a bit, and then he's put a multifocal IOL in the sulcus. So what happens is lens fragmentation is actually the major cause of inflammation in such cases. It causes a raise in IOP, and all particles have to be removed if they are in the anterior chamber. Because this is lens particles plus vitreous plus blood is actually a potential inciter for PVR development. So cataract is the most common form of injury. It is the main cause of visual disturbance apart from the astigmatism that is caused post-tear. So the progression can take place from minor to total in a couple of hours to years, and basically it's generally soft for such cases. Aspiration itself will do the job. So intervention should be influenced by the presence or the potential of the posterior segment pathology. So I'll just show a tear over here, one more tear. So what has happened over here is this is a secondary tear, the secondary IOL that is being implanted over here, the secondary cataract surgery after the primary tear was done. So these adhesions are very hard. So sometimes you have to go with a Varna scissor and you have to cut it out. So after the aspiration part, sometimes what you see over here is these plaques are there. So these plaques are the ones you have to go underneath it. You have to inject sometimes OVD underneath, and after injecting that OVD, you have to sometimes get that plane, and then you can cut with the Varnas, and basically then you can peel it off like a rexus. And once that is done, you get a good central area. After that, the synechia can be released. You can also use hooks in the middle while if there's any problem with the visualization of the pupil is small, followed by the implantation of a multifocal of a three-piece lens. So I won't go to this video. You can deal with subluxation cases. So imagine the goal over here, the most important point is to avoid iatrogenic damage to the retina. It is sometimes you have to sacrifice the lens, sacrifice it. The important point over here is not the IOL implantation, but it is a good wound integrity, no inflammation, no PVR changes, nothing. The retina has to be prevented. So preserving the capsule sometimes further increases the risk of anterior PVR and thysis also. So coming to the IOL implant, the primary and the secondary cataract extraction, primary is generally a single surgery and helps the prevention of secondary complications, mainly glaucoma, and gives immediate visual rehabilitation. However, what happens is after that post-operatively, you can have the advantage of that is you can put the IOL first in and later on it can be a problem. Secondary cases, what happens is that you can find the advantages that you give an optimal IOL power and you can manage astigmatism and you can put toric IOLs also and you can do it a better job. So coming to that, the timing is actually controversial and multiple people recommend different things. But primary, you would generally do in a child and a poor patient or a compliant patient who's not good, a poorly compliant patient who wouldn't come for a follow-up. Secondary is generally recommended because of lens inflammation and you can tackle the astigmatism as well. Coming to the biometry, sometimes what happens is you don't know the K readings of that. So you can take the A scan of the concerned eye and you can use the keratometry readings of the other eye and use that and then get the power. So single piece to multi piece depends. If the capsule bag is good, you can put a single piece IOL in the bag. If not, you can always put a multi piece IOL as well. Post-operatively control the inflammation, evaluate the fundus, that's very important, and suture management is always there. Yes, sir. I have one more after this.
Let me finish and can
sure, I? Sure, sir. Huh? Yeah, I'll just summarize. Yeah. So a small tear with cataract can be taken up for primary combined surgery. The lens fragments in the AC have to be removed. The anterior capsular tear management is controversial. Secondary IOL is recommended. And the goal is mainly to prevent the iatrogenic damage to the retina. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you very much, Karan, for the wonderful opportunity. I'll quickly go through these two cases. I want to show you the first case. This is a patient who is presented with a corneal tear and a mature cataract as well, and probably a retained intraocular formity. Look at this video very, very carefully. Just to keep you on the edge of the seat on a Sunday morning is very difficult, no? So I thought I'll just show you these two interesting cases. There's a retained intraocular foreign body, and endophthalmitis as well because of the foreign body. We didn't know the nature of the foreign body. The patient didn't give a proper history. So I did a extracapsular cataract extraction. You can see the corneal tear repair has been done by the referring ophthalmologist and they referred to me. And you can see something here, okay? Can anybody guess what it is? Yeah, it's an end-on view of this. So we made sure that the cornea is well protected. We didn't know what exactly was it because we tried to remove it. And we tried to do a bimanual technique to remove that, and because we do not know whether it's underlying, stuck to the underlying retina or the vitreous, and we were not very sure what's happening to the posterior extent of this particular foreign body, which is there. And then we tried to remove that. You can see that. I'll go through this a little faster because we're running short of time. Yeah. So once I removed that foreign body, you can see that this is a foreign body which I removed, totally intraocular, completely. And this is the drumstick, okay? The drumstick, which is a vegetable, which is there. And this, when I presented this in the American Academy, and they said, what is this drumstick? Whether it's a musical instrument, you know? But because the drumstick vegetable is not available in the US. And this drumstick, then subsequently I sutured the wound and then went in and did a pars plana vitrectomy as well. And because there was some evidence of vitritis also was there. And then you can see here, I did, and that was the end of the surgery. And that was a pars plana vitrectomy done for resting. This is the end of the surgery. This was done long time back, about 10 years back. So the patient is still doing very well with a fakie correction and contact lens. And this is the first week post-op. And this is a post-operative, about 612 N8 with contact lens, 2040. And you can see how the drumstick is. Try to pluck the drumstick from it. See, drumstick can be dangerous. It's actually a, I don't know whether South India is very common, this sambar wherein the drumstick is used for that. The harvesting drumstick, you can see that the drumstick has gone in like a missile into the eye and lodged into, gone through the cornea, gone through the lens and into the vitreous cavity as well. So this is what happened. The patient did very well after the surgery. This is the second patient, 34-year-old male laboratory worker, injury with the vernier caliper. God only knows how this vernier caliper went inside. What he did was, this guy tried to use the vernier caliper like a chisel and hammer. Okay, this is what you should not do. Okay, you can see that the vernier caliper was used like a chisel and hammer and went inside the eye. You can see here, this is the vernier caliper, and the patient had an underlying retinal attachment as well. Went in, he had a limbus to limbus corneal tear also, so the view was a little hazy. And you can see that I'm removing doing a good vitrectomy. The main thing in intraocular foreign body is to do a thorough vitrectomy, make sure that the this thing is mobile before you remove the intraocular foreign body from the vitreous cavity or from the underlying retina as well. You can see that the vernier caliper, the axis of the incision, so I had to make another corneal tear in this patient, and the caliper has come out of the eye. You can see that caliper, you don't have to see the measurement. The measurement is already there in the caliper. It's there on the caliper, 11 millimeter. The patient did very well, post-operative vision of 618. He had retinal attachment surgery with silicone oil implantation as well. Just to show you that there's intraocular foreign bodies, we can manage it very well, and the size of the intraocular foreign body does not matter. Early radical surgery, vitrectomy, removal of intraocular foreign body gives good results. Proper surgical techniques gives excellent gratifying results. Don't give up on these cases. If you are not a posterior segment surgeon, refer it to a posterior segment surgeon. But only thing is, refer them early. Refer them early, they do a thorough radical vitrectomy and remove the foreign body, and they can give fairly good results as well. Thank you very much, Karan, for the wonderful opportunity.
Thank you, sir. I'll just take 3 minutes more from the next set of speakers, if you would permit me, for my second talk. I'll just finish that in 3 minutes. So the next talk is on chemical injuries. So actually, chemical injuries is actually the true ophthalmic emergency, and it is the only way, injury where you can delay detailed history and examination. And so the injuries can vary from being an alkali injury to the acids to the irritants. The alkalis ones are the most dangerous, and the most common one that we encounter is the Chuna practice. So why are the alkalis, why are they a problem? Because they penetrate rapidly, sometimes less than a minute, particularly ammonia, and then they combine with these cell membrane lipids, the mucopolysaccharides and to collagen, and they cause disruption of the cells and the necrosis of the tissue. On the ocular surface, they cause saponification of the cell membranes and intercellular bridges, and this facilitates rapid penetration into the deeper layers, aqueous and vitreous as well. So necrosis of the conjunctival vessels also, blood vessels also takes place, giving a cooked fish eye appearance. The acids, they just denature proteins, they don't penetrate that much because they form a precipitate. The irritants, they just mainly cause some irritation over there, like a pepper spray or something, so they don't cause much damage. The severity of the burn depends on the surface area of the contact, the depth of penetration, the concentration of the substance, the time of contact, the time of interference, and the degree of the limbal stem injury. In fact, the most important point over here that comes up is the limbal stem injury, limbal stem cell injury. So the clinical picture can vary a lot from being pain, lacrimation, photophobia, blepharospasm, your diminution of vision. You can have corneal edema, you can have symblepharon formation. That's all, it's a varied picture over here. So this is the entire list. I'll just skip this part over here. So different classifications have been given by the Ropper Hall or the modified Hughes and the DUA classification. The major thing that they stress on is that the limbal involvement how much is the limbal involvement. So coming to the management, the goals is there to remove the offending agent, to promote ocular surface healing, controlling inflammation, preventing infection, and also controlling the IOP. The immediate management is to do a thorough saline wash. If somebody, it can be with a normal saline, RL, or a BSS, or sometimes if nothing is available, even tap water is good enough, you have to just wash, and extensively wash for about 20 minutes or so, avert the lid, double avert the lids, and look for any particles. These Chuna particles, they stick on there, they got a lot, so basically you have to remove a lot of that. So the history, then you can take a detailed history. Coming to the medical management, steroids are the mainstay of treatment. So steroids have to be given. You start prednisolone acetate. You can start dexamethasone. You can give steroid ointment as well. Coming to the ascorbic acid can be given. However, it is difficult to obtain, and along with citric acid. Tetracycline such as doxycycline can be given BD because these are collagenase inhibitors and also inhibit the neutrophil activity and hence by reducing the ulceration as well. So another thing is you have to give a lot of lubricants, topical antibiotics to prevent the infection. Sometimes if there's an epithelial defect, BCL can be applied. Autologous serum also has its roles. So IOP can be given by giving oral acetazolamide or beta blockers as the initial therapy. The IOP control, the initial rise takes place because of the inflammation part, and the second later end is because of the prostaglandin release. So later management also depends a lot on the lid formation, what deformity has formed. You can go for a conjunctival or mucous membrane graft at times also. Some people, if you don't have an amniotic membrane available, what you can do is you can do a tenonplasty, is that, you know, remove all the necrotic conjunctiva, all that ischemic area, all that necrotic area, and you can just advance the tenons onto the cornea where there's a problem over there. So I'll just show you a video of this is a photo. It's a non-healing epithelial defect that you see. So the amniotic membrane has got anti-fibrotic properties, it's anti-inflammatory, anti-angiogenic, and basically also covers the raw surface. So that this is a very good, and it's easily available everywhere. The landmark thing that came out is the slit. Now, in slit tissue, what you do is you just take out from the other eye, and sometimes if it's the other eye is also bad, then you can ask from a relative, and you take out this limbal stem cells from this area. And so this is a very post-chemical injury. This was a very big panus over here. So you'll be surprised when you start dissecting. And this patient was a young girl, 16-year-old. She had a lot of problems. And when you start dissecting it, you will actually be surprised. You can see a clear cornea over there. So this patient is doing well right now after 3 months of the surgery. And after this, you can apply an amniotic membrane. And that tissue that you had taken, you cut that into multiple small pieces and put it in two rings onto the place, apply it with fibrin glue, and then later on you can put a bandage contact. This can be done by a general ophthalmologist. This is not a difficult procedure. You just need to see a couple of videos. Dr. Basu's videos on YouTube are excellent on this. So sometimes you can go for a PK for that. Obviously, you'll refer to a cornea surgeon. And other options are the keratoprosthesis. So I'll just say prevention is very important for such cases. So education and training of the people around you is extremely important. And in workplaces like factories, tell them to wear, you know, goggles for protection. Thank you so much.
So that was a wonderful presentation, Karan. I have a question. Yeah. So in a previous talk about the management of lens during corneal tear, how do you plan it? So one of the videos we saw, there were sutures and you're managing the cataract as well. So how would you plan a cataract surgery in those? Your take on that?
See, you have to see the area of the trauma is the weak area. So you have to go a little bit away from that. Your ports have to be a little bit away from that. And you have, see, important, I always believe that you have to make your surgery easy. So you can shift around for the incision part. And the other problem is that you have a scar over there, so the visualization becomes a problem. But if what I did in that video that I had shown is that the synechia was there with the cornea. So I left it because that was attached, that was actually acting kind of like an iris hook. And also when you rotate the globe, that retro movement also gives you a good view. And if there is a problem, you can always use hooks to remove the iris. And I guess, yeah. And yeah. Always be ready for intraoperative surprises. Be slow and, yeah.
And another thing is, would you go for a suture removal and let the cornea stabilize to get the keratomatous stabilized?
Yes. This patient, you know, was insistent. That's why we had done it. But ideally, what you would do is, if there's no inflammation in the eye, you can go for a cataract surgery, ideally after 3 months of the suture removal, yeah.
I think we can wrap up this session. If there are any questions, you can personally ask any of us.
And I apologize to the next set of speakers for delaying our session a bit. Thank you so much.